Hey everybody, welcome back to Dreamforce 2025. We're here at Moscone South, a popular venue for theCUBE. First time theCUBE has been actually inside the venue. We've been at Dreamforce many, many years. My name is Dave Vellante, and my co-host George Gilbert and I are taking over for John Furrier and Gemma Allen, who are back in New York at our NYSE studio. Carrie McWilliams is here. She's the managing director at Deloitte Consulting. And we're excited to have you.
Absolutely, happy to be here.
You are a marketing whiz, I'm told. And you've actually at the forefront of understanding how agentic is affecting marketing.
Absolutely.
I don't have the marketing DNA. I just don't. And my wife does, but it's not in me. So what can you tell us about what's changing with marketing?
I mean, my goodness, it's everything. AI is really changing how marketers are interacting with all aspects of organizations. You really have the opportunity to reimagine how you're engaging with customers, and the marketing organization itself is really starting to transform because of that. Because you're starting to incorporate digital labor into that end-to-end workflow across marketing, which is just a fantastic way for us to really reimagine how we can re-engage.
You know, George, everywhere we look, the theme of scaling without labor, and it's all about digital, it's a profound change that I'm not sure, I mean, I think clearly you understand it in marketing, but it's going to have ripple effects across the industry, isn't
it? It's absolutely beyond, and I think a great opportunity here at Dreamforce, Salesforce shared their agentic enterprise vision, and love the call out that it's beyond marketing, because it really is. It's providing that connected experience across sales, service, marketing, commerce, and beyond with a unified profile with Data Cloud.
So how are you applying this technology? Maybe you could share some examples. Where are your priorities? Actually, you know, step back, because you had a million things you could do. How did you prioritize, pare it down, and what did you attack?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think as we've had conversations with brands and with customers, we're really starting to step back, look at the end-to-end marketing workflow, the key personas that exist across the marketing lifecycle, and look at opportunities to reduce any repetitive tasks, reduce handoffs in workflow, and I'll talk a bit more about that in a minute, so that we can really increase speed to market for campaigns. And that's really the magic here, is being able to increase efficiency and leverage that digital labor to augment your existing team.
Is there an analytics angle here that's different than the sort of, you know, post-event analytics and more real-timeness built in?
There is, and so with marketing, you have so much data. There's behavioral data, there are the interactions that you have on the website, there's customer feedback, and now with AI, you have the ability to process that data, feed that into an LLM, and use that to change how you're interacting in a real-time fashion, as you mentioned.
So, picking up on that, a couple questions. Maybe you can elaborate a little more on the theme of looking at the personas and sort of managing the handoffs or eliminating the handoffs.
Sure.
So this is on the brand side.
Yep.
You know how it changes the work, but that key thing was speed for the campaign. But one other thing, which is then a feedback loop, like learning from it. Maybe elaborate on how that works now.
Sure, absolutely. So I think a good example here might be a campaign strategist or brief manager who's going to be responsible for setting that overall vision and strategy for the company. Yeah. You can now leverage an agent front end to help with a lot of those planning and analysis tasks so that the marketer themselves can focus much more on the strategy. And what they're going to do is they're going to take the outputs from the agent and instead of having created themselves at the front end, you're interacting with the agent to come up with a better output and test and learn through that approach so that you can refine the output and focus then on that faster time to market.
And when you say test, are you talking about like doing A/B tests?
So you could do A/B, you're doing A/B tests if you're further along in the life cycle.
Yeah.
If you're front end and we're talking about just campaign brief creation, you might be interacting via the Slack interface that was demoed here at Dreamforce.
So the whole cycle time is compressed.
It compresses significantly.
And what about then in the campaign itself, if you have not just the faster cycle time, but you have greater productivity for the sort of, I guess, campaign manager, can they do more, with the help of analytics and agents, more fine-grained, more personalized sort of campaigns themselves?
Absolutely.
Rather than buckets.
Exactly, and that's the magic here, is being able to have those more personalized interactions across channels to the right channels at the right time.
And what
leveraging
are those channels?
That's based on the insights and behaviors. So you're looking at the customer intent, real-time intent based on if I'm browsing a website, looking at products, so that I can then surface the right interaction at the right time so I can have better engagement.
So okay, so you've got Marketing Cloud, you know, 2.0. I can't get the
name straight. Next gen marketing.
Data Cloud is now Data 360, right?
Got
and
it.
We talked about, you know, analytics. So earlier you talked about personalization. So how are those pieces coming together to drive personalization?
Absolutely. So you want to think about this almost in layers. So with Marketing Cloud Next, or Agentforce Marketing,
thank you.
Of course. This is built on top of Data Cloud. So it's native with Data Cloud, and this is really a huge unlock for businesses and brands, because you're able to leverage all of the data and insights in Data Cloud with that unified customer profile. And we talked about data just a few moments ago. So you're ingesting all of the data into Data Cloud so that you can have that enriched and unified customer profile to activate on in channels with Marketing Cloud Next.
What are you seeing, thinking about how Salesforce positions Agentforce, what are you seeing is the drivers of adoption in customers, and what are the big barriers? What has to be resolved?
We talked a bit about efficiency gains, so that's a big one. How can I be more efficient with my operations? Another one is, how do I increase engagement and personalization? But we really need to step back and expand beyond just marketing, because we're seeing a lot of initial adoption in sales or service scenarios, where I'm able to really test, learn, and have interactions for processing reservation requests or simpler requests that don't need to be handled by an agent, that can then be handled by a person, that are now handled by an agent.
Go ahead, please.
Well, on picking up on that answer, it sounds almost like there's perhaps a blurring of what were functionally separate, sales, service, and marketing, and that you're thinking of like this customer or prospect and the life cycle, and there are different activities that might be appropriate for that individual rather than working as historical segments and classes.
Absolutely, it's that one-to-one interaction based on your individual preferences, your behaviors, your intent, with how you're engaging with the brand and where you're engaging with the brand, so that you're able to have that more meaningful interaction.
Okay, last question then on this topic, but it sounds like to do that really effectively, you really need the broader Salesforce footprint. It's much harder if you're trying to piece together some, you know, third-party components.
Absolutely, so if you have the Salesforce core platform with sales, service, and all of that can be unified with Data Cloud, absolutely, it's a very, very powerful interaction for our customers.
Were you here for the keynote on Tuesday?
I was,
okay.
I was.
So, Mark, every person that he held the mic with said, what's your vision? So what's your vision for marketing? We've gone from kind of spec sheets and websites, and now you're talking about a completely different world. Lay out your vision.
Absolutely. So this is one where it's actually really exciting, because we've for a long time been talking about the end-to-end life cycle, and I mentioned moving from weeks and months of working through a campaign process to get that brief or the campaign out the door. That's now being reduced to days. That's so exciting. So the vision here is looking at how agentic can support and really catapult organizations to the forefront, leveraging agentic as that additional support for your marketers.
From a business model standpoint, this is a weird question. Does that mean you can raise prices, or you can just do more, or both?
Should I answer that?
I know. You don't have to answer the first part, but the second part, clearly you'll have more capacity, and we'll see about the market will determine what
of course,
the prices are.
You have more capacity with your digital labor workforce that augments your existing workforce. So it's really having organizations step back and understand what makes sense, where are you leveraging these agents across the life cycle, whether that's content creation, we talked about brief creation, or some of those predictive insights that you're able to then use to come up with those better campaigns.
When you talk to people who don't have the marketing gene, like myself, what do you think is most misunderstood about the opportunities that exist in marketing, and maybe think about some of your customers that might be struggling with, with the future.
I think something that is somewhat misunderstood is how important data is to this whole process. And it always comes back to data, always, always, always. So just wanted to reemphasize that, because you think about marketing as the touch points and interactions, which it absolutely is. But if you're reaching out with the wrong data, you don't have the right context for the customer, you have outdated data, then the reach out is not going to be effective. You're not going to get the ROI on the campaign or the engagement you're looking for on a website, for example.
And your Salesforce relationship, what's your vision for that? Where do you see it going? Maybe even if I asked you a year from now, what would you like to be able to say with your Salesforce partners that you can't say today?
So we're currently a Salesforce, Agentforce launch partner, as well as a launch partner for Data Cloud. Would love to continue. We really value our partnership together. So I'd love to continue the collaboration that we have with Salesforce now on the marketing front to continue to release new and effective agents out in market.
I want to go back to that efficiency and personalization theme. Because it sounds like there's, like the cycle time can improve dramatically, but I'm also wondering, has measurement effectiveness improved so that you know attribution, like where in the journey and which touch points have contributed how much, to the value of the customer?
Yeah, absolutely. So with the latest reporting and analytics tools and capabilities that exist even within Marketing Cloud Next, you start to get a different view on what campaigns are most effective, touch points are most effective, and then with some of the key features and capabilities within Marketing Cloud, you can then leverage that to do send-time optimization and other things so that you can send campaigns out at the right time based on that data.
So it's both the efficiency, the targeting, and the measurement.
Absolutely.
So everything's gotten better.
Yep. Then,
I imagine historically this has been mostly specialized vendors that have been, competition. But when you emphasize data, drives everything, that would seem to favor someone with a broader footprint, an application footprint that then turns into Data Cloud, because then the Data Cloud information about the customer's richer.
Yeah.
That seems to be like a self-reinforcing cycle where like the Salesforce footprint is just going to keep expanding.
Yeah, so if you think about how and where Marketing Cloud Next sits in the overall stack, one, agree with your statement, but two, you need to have both the data cloud expertise as well as marketing so that you're able to activate on the data effectively, find those segments, and then use those via data cloud. So agree, you're looking for someone that has that hybrid blend of skill set and expertise across both data, tech, and then marketing.
So this is obviously a big show for you guys.
Of course.
What's next for the year?
Oh, what's next? I love the ping on what's next. So we have a number of events coming up. We'll continue thought leadership. We just published a thought leadership guide out, which is active now, on Marketing Cloud Next, best practices and adoption approaches. So that's very top of mind.
On your website?
On our
obviously.
Website,
yeah, okay.
Of course, so you can find it there.
Okay.
And we'll continue to host a number of webinars on some of the key points of view within that.
And who attends those webinars? Who
is it's
CMOs?
Open.
What's the typical?
Directors, CMOs, it's anyone that's interested in marketing, so it is an open invitation for those type of webinars, so that we can, one, educate people on the power of what's available now, because it's truly exciting and we're changing how marketing organizations are functioning, and then two, sharing a bit on our accelerators so that we can help.
Sounds like a great freebie for people who want to learn.
Absolutely.
Carrie, thanks so much for coming on theCUBE. It's great to have you.
Of course. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you for watching. This is Dave Vellante for George Gilbert at Dreamforce 2025. You're watching theCUBE. We'll be right back right after this short break from San Francisco.